So we're fairly behind schedule. I think we're just going to get started now, and then people can drift in. Welcome to the lunch session. The focus here is on businesses and companies, for-profit entities, using the SPI to drive sustainable business. You've got a kind of a double whammy in the session. We're going to have Marcelo here present. Oh, we had the wrong case study name here, too. We'll fix that in a second. Which is a really compelling case study from the Amazon. I'll be following up then with a case study with Win-Win about the depths of the food deficit in the U.S., and I'm going to introduce a tool called the Win-Win Wiki. And then we like to do, depending on time, is open up for Q&A, and if there's still enough time, depending on what time they close us up, we'd actually like to do a live case study with an example from the audience here where we can kind of talk about collectively. Does it sound good? All right. So without further, let me get, we'll jump over here. So I'd like to introduce Marcelo. And Marcelo holds a master's degree in political economy with a focus on human development indicators. He has over 10 years of experience in research and project management in the public and private sector organizations. Marcelo is currently the responsible manager for the Social Progress Index in South America with SPI Global Partner, the Avena Foundation. Please welcome Marcelo to the stage.
Thank you. Thank you. This case is very important because it's the first application of SPI in the subnational initiatives with primary data, so data collected from the people using questionnaires. And it's also a very important case of how business can benefit from the methodology. This project, now let me introduce the partner. So Avena Foundation has been with SPI since the early beginning, since we've been global partners since 2011. And from this special initiative took part Coca-Cola and Natura, that is a $3 billion cosmetics company from South America. We're going to talk about a case in the small city of Caraguari in the state of Amazonas, Brazil. So beforehand, I'd like to deliver some ideas, the main ideas of the presentation. First, it's hard to promote social change alone. It's always easier if you can engage other stakeholders and make a collaborative work. Second, SPI can help to build a common vision by providing a common language that we talk about something of this this morning. SPI is useful to set priorities that drives action. And in this particular case, I found it very interesting that it could break down the power dynamics between donor and the recipient, fostering a territory-based development and building autonomy and empowerment. So just so you can have this some idea, the city I'm talking about is a municipality in Brazil that's around 25,000 square kilometers, about one-fourth of Iceland, or maybe the size of Israel. And it's close to Peru, Colombia, and Venezuela. And then zooming here, we have a map that all this area, this huge area, has only 48,000 people living in, split it in the urban area of Caraguari and the rural area. In the rural area, there are over 50 communities living in the shores of the middle section of this river called Juruá River. So these people, some people live like 4-5 hours by boat to the closest city. And of course, that drives a lot of problems. For example, lack of access to school, of primary education, lack of access to technology, to communications, and other issues. So what was the motivation and implementation for the companies? Both companies, Coca-Cola in Brazil, has a shared value strategy. And both of them wanted to generate shared value within the supply chain. This phrase is from Natura's manager, relationships that transcends buying and selling. They've been working on that for at least 15 years now. To strengthen the partnership with local collectors of native materials, of seeds and other valuable materials from Amazon. Economic integration with local production and cooperatives, and also to securely supply a supply chain in a sustainable manner. So they just figure out to keep Amazon alive is necessary to integrate it economically, and the way they did it instead of devastating the forest is by extraction, by collection of raw materials that can be replaced by nature, so keeping the forest alive. So how they did it? By the end of 2014, Natura and COCA proposed the creation of a local development forum with regular meetings to discuss not only their company's strategy and the direct implication of their action in the territory, but the full picture of the region's development alternatives. This is a picture of one of the meetings. And the question that was posed around April on 2015, around the third or fourth meeting, was how to set a process of public deliberation capable of identifying priorities for the territory and really engage people, engage stakeholders, and social change. So this, the important thing about this community that's most based on civil society with companies, but also public sector, like the mayor of the city and some state organs, including environmental regulatory organs of the Amazon. So the tool was why SPI sounded appealing by the time. First, it's an holistic framework. It can cover many, many aspects of our life. It provides the framework based in three dimensions and 12 components, as most you already know. And it was easy to communicate. So it was an easy way to communicate on a 0 to 100 scales, decomposable by component, so that companies could understand, the mayor could understand, universities could understand. So by building that kind of understanding, it was possible to deliver solid projects that I'm going to talk briefly. But before, let me just share the results, the main findings. So we have the scales for the global SPI. The Amazon cities is another project that used secondary data to calculate over 700 municipalities in Brazil. And the Caravari, done by survey, this last box, urban and rural. So the first thing we found is that rural Caravari has a level of deprivation significantly higher than the urban area and the municipality overall. Access to higher education is a visible challenge for all levels in Brazil, Amazon cities, Caravari, and the world, by the way. But in rural Caravari, the situation is quite alarming. Rural Caravari performs significantly better in personal safety, and rural Caravari performs significantly worse in water and sanitation, shelter, access to information, communication, and higher education. Those in dark are areas that some special projects were deployed in partnership within the network. So let me quote or cite only three projects that are related to the identified challenges. The first one was in water and sanitation. Those people wouldn't have access to bathroom and to clean water for drinking. There has been placed a rainwater collection project that built a bathroom building for around 500 families, with local association reaching international funds for upscaling. So they had, through the data, they have empowered themselves. They went to the capital of Brazil to ask for an already existing program to reach their location that otherwise wouldn't reach because it's very expensive to getting there and to building sanitation projects. Another interesting project is that because people live so far, like in the riverbed, there weren't primary schools. So they have partnered with the University State of Amazonas to train teachers in order to build new private schools for primary education. Another interesting one is in higher education. The index detected that higher education was a failure, was a deprivation suffered from the local population. But only the collaborative talking could find that the best thing would be a specialized course programs on sustainable collection of the forest raw materials. So it's a global challenge, but adapted to the local scenario and answering to the local population needs. What works, what worked, and the next steps. So the forum continues to hold regular meeting. That's very important. The SPI communities model is spreading the region with over three projects in Brazil and one concluded project in Chile based on survey and community development, always with a boost group. SPI Caravari, the phase two is in progress to be released this semester. The researchers already came back from the field, and it will be a measure of collective impact in the region. And the third section is forecasted to early 2019. So we have like three, the zero line, the baseline, intermediate evaluation, and a final evaluation. And local farm is also negotiating. They empower themselves so much that their negotiation funds to upscale interventions with international donors, evidencing a growing level of autonomy. Take-home ideas. SPI is very effective in building a common vision by providing a common language to stakeholders. SPI is useful to set priorities that drive action. And the adaptation of SPI into the territory is a participative process that enables territory-based development, empowering stakeholders. Thank you very much. Now the most difficult part. Tak fihich.
We won't have Icelandic language lessons later on. Marcel and I just met yesterday, and one of the things I found interesting when I was going through his work and then looking at the work we do is just the commonality of trying to bring companies together with the public sector, with the nonprofits to try to affect the change. And that's what we try to do at Win-Win. So I'll give you just a little bit of a setup, then I'm going to go through a case study. We've been working with a super interesting company. We'll show you how we've been using the SPI to help make them more effective. But what we're really interested in this concept about, as I mentioned in my earlier comments, how do you get the best assets out of each sector to come together to really create the type of change we want to see in the world and make all that happen. And I'll just give you the framework that we use are these four things. We think that if we're going to find the money out there with this $5 to $7 trillion gap, it's highly unlikely the economy is going to grow fast enough. We know we can't donate enough money, and we're certainly not going to be able to tax ourselves to solve that financing gap for any of these problems. So we think that the only reasonable opportunity to solve this at scale is to really repurpose all the money that's already been spent, all the existing investments, and the money that's already being spent. But to repurpose them in ways that are innovative with alignment, which you're going to see here in the case. And we think it's also really important to harness the power of self-interest, not just for companies with their own core business, profit and growth, but importantly, the self-interest of the 501c3, so they can serve their clients, and the self-interest of the government program or government agency and their interest in serving citizens. But all that self-interest has to be through the common lens of a common benefit, and that common lens is either the SPI or the SDGs. So the case study, this is a small company based in New York and Brooklyn. There are some Stanford undergrads who got out about 5 years ago, very good at coding. And if you haven't heard about them yet, I think you're going to hear a lot about them in the coming years, because what they're doing we think is really phenomenal. We've been working with them for about a year and a half now, helping them develop these tri-sector strategies, and I hope you'll find it interesting in terms of how the SPI shows up here. So the setup for the company, can I see how many companies are in the room, since this is a company focused? Okay. So as companies, this is the market these guys work with. They are servicing, their market is 45 million unique users who have $80 billion of spending power, and somebody else built a robust cloud database. And many private sector companies will go, oh, that's a pretty interesting market. But it's actually food stamps in the US. And in the United States, when you're poor and you don't have enough money to put food on the table, the government provides a debit card to you, and that debit card gets loaded up. And it's a national program from the Department of Agriculture. And the Department of Agriculture then hands that money to the states, and the states hire credit card companies to actually administer these debit cards. And it's stunning to me, this is about double the number of people in the U.S. who are on food stamps from 10 years ago. So it used to be 1 in 14. In the last 10 years, we're now 1 in 7. So if you just think about the SDGI metrics, depth of the food deficit, we are clearly falling behind. As a country. But our approach with them has been, rather than kind of engaging the political debates, we're wondering if we can simply make the program work better. And we call the user Maria, and we have developed a system for her that's live in the US now that we're very excited by. And the system really takes this approach of using the best assets from all three sectors so we can give her more spending power, give her access to information about where she is and what services she can access, and also get information about employment. And we think at scale we can actually save the federal government billions by making the program more effective and more efficient. So the way food stamps work, this is an app that they've created. And I'm going to walk you through the three different sectors and the assets and then how we actually use the SPI to find these things. So the way the system works today, if you're Maria, you get about $250 a month for your food, and those benefits last you about 2 weeks, and then you run out. So when you're shopping, knowing how much money on your card is a really important use case, because you don't want to have that potentially embarrassing moment when you go to check out at the check stand and not have enough money. And the way the system works before Propel is that your balance is printed at the bottom of the receipt when you're done. When you're done shopping, which is nice to know that you'd have $58, but it's actually the wrong time to get the information when you're done shopping. So what they figured out is that Maria will actually come into the store and she'll buy a candy bar or a soda before she shops so she can get her balance. Then she'll go shop, figure out how much money she has left to make sure she runs out. So these guys were clever and they said, well, we can fix that. We can build an app for that. So they built this app. Turns out that 70% of food stamp users have smartphones in the US, and that number is growing. And smartphone and mobile technology is an increasing way that goods and services can be delivered. So what they did is they downloaded the balance. So you can see that she has $58, really nice thing, so she can tell all the time, 7 days a week, 24 hours a day, how much money she has on her food stamps. But what they didn't realize is when they downloaded the balance, they actually got all the transaction history. So they actually know where she shopped for the last 12 months. So when I started talking with them, I'm like, wait a second, you're telling me you have market share data on up to $80 billion of spending power in the US supermarket industry? And they're like, yeah, I guess so. So we decided to have some fun with it. So we essentially take those data sets on behalf of Maria and we make her what we call visible and valuable to the retail community. So we can walk into a chain in the US, one supermarket chain, call it chain A, and we can tell them that they have about 10% of the market share here. And Walmart, let's say, has 20%. And we'll say, chain A, would you be willing to give Maria $5 more off on her shopping trip if she normally shops at Walmart and she switches to your store? Which is a very powerful thing. And we think we can actually get her about an extra $100 a month, so from $250 to $350 of value, just by taking her data sets and aggregating them and using that data to harness the power from the manufacturers and the retailers, which we're very excited by. This is the great private sector company. We think it's going to grow and scale. They're attracting top-tier financing from venture capitalists and whatnot. We're really excited for them. But the win-win model and the SPI model says, can you go further? Can you actually make this system better if you include the other sectors? So the next thing they do here is they actually bring in public sector assets. So they geolocate exactly where she is. This is actually a location in Brooklyn. I can show this to you live if you're interested afterwards. And those orange dots are actually the locations of the stores that accept SNAP benefits. So it's helpful her to know where she can actually spend her SNAP benefits. There's a shocking number of high-priced convenience stores and gas stations, by the way, where food stamps are taken. And where the app is going is we'll be able to tell her what a common basket would cost. So like chicken, rice, and beans would cost her $29 at one store, $32 at another one, $34 at another. So not only have we made her visible and valuable, but we've given her power and choice about where to go, making her smarter as a shopper. But you'll notice the other two things down there. We see that that yellow tab called summer meals. Well, it turns out Maria's probably got two kids, and when her kids are in school, the government provides free breakfast and lunch during the school year. But when the school year's out, the government provides free breakfast and lunch throughout the summers. So we decided to take that public sector asset and we geolocated every single summer meals program in the country. So Maria could look at her phone and say, show me the closest school or church where I can have my kids fed. Incredibly useful information for her. And I mentioned earlier the farmers markets. That's a city government program, actually funded by the federal program. And what the cities do is they will double the value of Maria's food stamp benefits if she buys fresh vegetables at a farmers market, which is a great idea because it promotes health and long-term well-being. The challenge is these farmers markets, this program isn't that well known, so now we tell her about it so she can actually utilize it. And secondarily, the farmers markets often are not in the food, not in these food deserts. So what we do now is go to the farmers market and say, hey, we have 300 Marias in this area. Would you be interested in setting up a mobile farmers market from 4 to 8 p.m. on Friday afternoon? We'll send her a message via the app and we'll create a whole closed loop marketing system. So that's just kind of cool for her. She loves that, right? We've had about 600,000 downloads in the last 6 months in this app, and it's one of the most popular apps out there right now. But the last thing in the win-win model says social sector. So what can we do with her from the social sector assets? And it's kind of faded here, but we did hear there was a small 501c3 in New York called Alice, which created a microfinance facility for riding the subway in New York. If you're poor, you need to get to work. It's very expensive to buy the daily pass, much cheaper to buy the monthly pass, but you don't have the money to buy the entire monthly pass. So Alice needed customers, and so we advertised them on the Propel platform for free. And what we're doing now is we're actually starting to list all the 501c3s in her area, and we're creating a resource wallet. So if she needs nutrition counseling or childcare or job training, she can find who are the 501c3s that actually can provide her services. So what Maria has is actually all three sectors giving her benefits that are useful. So it becomes an incredibly useful app for her. And what Propel has as a company is that it has a strategic relationship, no contract with the government, but essentially uses assets that it didn't have to build to make the app more powerful. And it's a win-win. So for instance, the 501c3s are promoting Propel as an app and essentially are functioning as a distribution channel for Propel, which is a nice win-win going back and forth. Everybody with me on that? Okay. Think about trying to compete against this company if you didn't use the assets from all three sectors. I would submit this company is going to have superior growth and superior returns because it uses a tri-sector approach. So that's the case. Let's zoom out a little bit. Think about your own companies. What we do now with our 501c3 is we work with lots of companies, little ones and big ones. And what we've realized, there are thousands of government programs, city, county, state, federal level, and thousands of nonprofits. We think those are all opportunities to repurpose those assets and leverage them in ways that are collaborative on a win-win basis. And what we've learned to do is to ask three questions to companies. And it's interesting, now our work has not only taken us from startups like Propel, but to Fortune 100 companies like GM and Microsoft, Zillow and T-Mobile, who have real assets and big assets. And it's interesting, when we talk to companies, we talk to them about working like this, and they don't get it in the beginning. And I encourage all of you to think about your own organizations in this framework when you go back. The three questions we ask aren't hard, but they're powerful. The first question we ask a private sector company who we work with is we say, what's your private sector strategy? And they all have a good answer, right? That's what private sector companies do. Then we ramp it up a little bit and we say, what's your social sector strategy? How do you actually work with 501c3s? And not donations, which we're big fans of, but what work are you doing with a 501c3 that's good for your core business profit and growth, and it's mission aligned with what the 501c3 is trying to accomplish for its clients? Not many companies have a good answer to this, but they can. The one that really freaks companies out is this last one. We ask them, how do you work with government? And the typical answer is, don't tax us, don't regulate us, get out of the way, you're bad for my business. But we ask them the same question. We say, are there any assets in the public sector at any level that actually would be good for your core business? And what are you doing in your core business strategy that's good for your own core profit and growth that's also mission aligned with what the public sector is doing? And people scratch their heads a little bit and have to figure it out. But I point out to them, Propel found an $80 billion market in the Department of Agriculture. I founded a company in the US called Coinstar, which found a $150 billion market. And I would submit there are massive assets in the public sector that can be collaboratively leveraged in a win-win manner. So the thing to think about, we've created a whole system around this. The question is how to do this. I'm gonna skip this. But what we've done is we've created a tool using the SBI to make it easy for companies to find these tri-sector opportunities that can drive not only financial returns, but strong social returns that are not only collaborative, but synergistic. And what I like to show you is how it works. I gave you the background earlier, so I'm kind of repeating myself here, but this is the SBI piece. And what we've done is we've mapped companies, government programs, and nonprofits to the SBI. So we've done this now in three states in the US, a little bit in Costa Rica, and we actually have a lot of more use cases coming. But it's been fascinating. So if you want to know who's working on homelessness in Seattle, we can show you the government programs, the nonprofits, and the private sector companies, which is fun. We're also doing the same thing with the SDGs. So same question here. This is a great impact lens. It's great that we have metrics around it. Who's actually doing the work? Who are the companies? Who are the nonprofits? And who are the 501c3s who are actually going to do the work, and what are their resources? So the tool we built, and I'll just show it to you here, you should see an Excel spreadsheet. All of this is going online. It's all going to a wiki on the web when we get it all figured out here, which shouldn't be too far away. Let me see if I can get my, is my cursor going to come over here? Here it goes. So you guys can see the SPI framework here. Everybody with me on that? Hang on. Remind me later. Sorry, I'm having to drive in a way that doesn't make sense here. But let's say there's a lot of use cases for this, but let me just show you one simple one. Let's say you're a company in New York like Propel that's working with the depth of the food deficit and you want to create a collaborative strategy. So you'd go to basic human needs, you'd go to nutrition, and you'd go to depth of the food deficit. And you can see here in Washington State that there are 25, that's not highlighting, 25 public sector programs in the state of Washington that work on the depth of the food deficit. Interesting to note, there are 132 501c3s in the state of Washington that work on the depth of the food deficit. So if you're Propel, you can open this up and say, well, gee, what are those 25 programs? We can look inside the public sector, and we can see that there are 9 at the city level and 11 at the state level. And if we open up the cities, we can look at the city of Seattle, and we can see there are 6. And what do we find inside of the city of Seattle? We find this program called FreshBucks. I don't know what that is. Let me take a look. And it actually doubles the value of SNAP benefits at Seattle farmers markets. Didn't know about that. Does anybody else do it? Yes. Turns out a national program. Maybe we should put it on an app and put it out for Maria across the country. See how that process worked? Similarly, we came down here and said, what's this thing called Seattle Summer Meals? Well, that provides the no-cost breakfast, lunch, and dinners. How can we do that? That ends up in the app as well. So we showed this to the Seattle Foundation, they were having fun with it, and they knew about both programs, but they didn't realize that the state of Washington, does something very similar with the senior farmers markets, which is fun. So this is a way to kind of discover what the assets are and create innovation and alignment around this. I won't go through the whole thing, but essentially we've done it for the social sector, so find all the food banks in the social sector. In the private sector, you'll find all the supermarkets and all the restaurants, and what can they do with food waste. So that's the first look at the wiki. The second thing on there, if I can get to it, is we mapped out the resources. So we mapped out all the spending, so we can figure out who actually has the money that can be repurposed and realigned. And there's some double counting going on here, because it's a pivot table. We've mapped out $2.9 trillion in the state of Washington. I find it really interesting that a lot of money goes into basic nutrition and medical care, and very little money goes into tolerance and inclusion. So if the world isn't doing very well in tolerance and inclusion, we're not actually investing in tolerance and inclusion. And the last thing we've done on the wiki is we've tracked the metrics. So what we've done here is we've taken the SPI metrics for the whole US, and I'll just show you one example. If you're interested in maternal mortality is measured and as deaths per 100,000 live births in the US. And the good news is it's dropped. It's dropped from 14.1 to 13.75 over the last 3 years. Well, conceptually, we think if we want to solve the problem of maternal mortality, that is not exclusively a government problem or a nonprofit problem or a private sector problem. So who's on the team for that? And we can actually look in and see who's on the team for maternal mortality. We'll have a list for all the public sector programs, all the private sector companies, and all the social sector stuff. Guys, make sense what we've done here, sort of the systems map? So all of this is happening now on the web, we hope in about 6 months. And where it's going is we want to create a resource for all companies to be able to develop these strategies. We've been deploying it on a city-by-city basis. We partner with universities, so we've done 3 cities in the US plus a little bit of work in Costa Rica. Oxford's very interested in bringing this to the UK, and we're now rolling out to Chicago and Detroit. So it's coming to a city near you soon, we hope. And then ultimately our goal is to actually make this a global wiki so that any company or any government or any 501c3 anywhere in the world can use this as a resource to ask questions like, who are my natural partners, what are their resources, and how are we doing as a team to drive outcomes on the SPI and the SDGs? So just some comments on the SPI before I wrap up here. Everyone talks a lot about the metrics. We think the framework itself is really powerful, and it's a way to create a common language between the sectors. The metrics do matter, and what we love about the SPI, it has the ability to be localized and relevant. I can tell you stories about that. We've been shocked about how well it has worked for this work and how practical it has been to actually find real solutions for companies to develop these sort of strategies. And just from working with the SPI a lot, I can tell you that many people in the U.S. don't know about it, but when they hear about it, they intuitively like it and they get it and they can relate to it. It's an understandable resource, and it works well at universities, it works well at companies, companies love it, works well with governments and nonprofits. And one of my favorite comments was that this can be a lens to unite us both intra-sector and inter-sector, which I think is a very powerful opportunity. So I'll stop the case study there, and the take-home I'd like to leave you with, and you can do this for any of the companies that you work with. If you're not a company, if you're a nonprofit, you can go through the same process and come up with the same solution or a slightly different solution for the same piece. And if you're a government program, you can do the same thing. But for this session, I just put it in the framework of a company. So the process that we go through when we sit down with a company like Propel, or T-Mobile, or Microsoft, they're interested in finding financial returns and social returns and environmental returns, preferably ones that are synergistic. So we have them do three things. We have them answer that first question. We ask them, what's your private sector strategy? And they have a good answer. Then we ask them a basic question about what are their assets. Then we show them the SPI and we say, okay, given your assets and your strategy, what's the impact area that your core assets could have an effort on? And not all companies figure this out immediately, like Weyerhaeuser, the timber company, doesn't think they're on the team for homelessness, but they're actually on the team for homelessness because they have a lot of extra resources when it comes to building materials. The second thing we have companies do, and they use the wiki to do this, we say, who are your natural partners? Who else is on that SPI or SDG impact team in the social and public sector? That's often surprising to people. People don't think about it this way. Then we ask them to say, what are their assets? So we got a pile of assets from all three sectors lined up. And then we have fun. Then we start to think about how can you repurpose those assets and how can they be realigned? And we've done this now with about 30 companies. We have yet to fail with coming up with some surprising, unexpected answer. And I encourage you guys to all do this, and it's been fascinating. Let me know what you find. It's often surprising where it takes you. So brainstorm, play, and innovate. And the last thing you do is create these collaborative cross-sector strategies. I want to emphasize these aren't traditional public-private partnerships. These are actually collaborative win-win strategies that are out there. For instance, Propel does not have a contract with the Department of Agriculture. It simply takes the asset that it had already created, and it was a decent program, but it turbocharged the program by creating the app and leveraging the data set out there. And then when you create those strategies, make sure you use a win-win mindset. So the only way these things are going to sustain and grow is it has to be good for each sector, and each sector's self-interest has to be served, otherwise this won't sustain year after year after year. We think this generates higher returns, greater impact at scale, and will improve the SPI metrics. So that's that case. So what we want to do now is open it up to Q&A for Marcel and I. And depending on how much time we have left, we can do Q&A, and then we'd do a live case study if anybody wants to bring up a company or an impact area and see what we come up with as a group. Do we have a mic for questions, or? Yeah.
Fantastic presentations and ideas and congrats both. Two comments, if I may, and perhaps they are not questions, but could bring answers, even if they are comments. One, Marcelo, we have been talking the last days a lot, but I see a great, great opportunity of, I do not represent here UN, but I work with UN and particularly on trade and sustainable development issues. And we have a long-standing program on bio trade, products of biodiversity, sustainably used, that could create, that actually creates opportunities for communities, local communities, post-conflict situations like in Indonesia or in Colombia, in Peru as well. And the metrics of SPI adopted by our program, I think it would be fantastic because it would be a better benchmarking of our own programs and into the future. So I take it as a first comment, I take it as a homework to really liaise Marcelo and all of you with my colleagues. But the comment, Jan, and congratulations also for this very innovative approach of mapping and linking it with the SPI. Have you thought about, since you're already having in mind bringing this mapping of assets, public and private assets, to developing countries, thought about the challenges of informality, in the great degree of informality that you have, and therefore lack of information in many markets, and lack of contestable markets? Because what I see when I see all your mappings is very competitive markets in which you don't have perhaps the bottlenecks monopolies or oligopolies that you have in transport and the very basic provision of basic services and goods in many developing countries. Have you thought about that?
Yeah, so we have. The only international case that we worked with a little bit with Jaime and Inkai last year, which is really just a first step forward, several people have asked us to take this mapping work to India, to Africa, to developing countries. We have not done that yet. When we have funding for that and when we have a local partner, we look forward to doing that. But we think there'll be certainly issues around data and information flow, and not all governments are as open as the U.S. with being able to get information, and not all 501c3 sectors are as open as the U.S. So it'll be more challenging to get the information, but we still think that the process itself will create inherent transparency, and it's not going to happen overnight, but if you run this system forward over the next 10, 20, 30 years, we think it could be transformative, and we're going to learn as we go, and we've already been learning a ton. Is that responsive to the question?
Yes, indeed.
Okay. Other questions? Hands up. Yeah.
I like that example of that company, Propel. Propel was the name, right?
Yes.
So because it's nice to see how by tapping into new opportunities, a new company can grow. Yep. Being an entrepreneur myself, I love that. But so what I'm wondering about how, because at the end it doesn't create new money, it redistributes money, you know, which grocery stores or someone else would spend on marketing or whatever. They give it now to Maria. How does it help the SDGs if money just gets redistributed instead of new money gets created?
Oh, I love this question. So I happen to know a lot about supermarkets. In a former life, I created a company that rolled out 30,000 supermarkets in the U.S. So supermarkets compete to market to the vast majority of consumers all the time, and they spend heaps of money to get little bits of market share. And at the end of the day, traditionally, food stamp users are considered low-margin customers who are harder to reach and somewhat ignored by the industry. But by taking that data set, we actually make them very powerful and very relevant. And if all the manufacturers and the retailers compete to give Maria an extra $100 a month, but they don't move their own market share at all, that's fine, because we've achieved the goal. What we wanted to do was, we are her advocate, and we're using the data on her behalf, so she gets the extra $100 of spending power. So we're helping to achieve the SDGs and the SBI if we can reduce hunger, if we can reduce the depth of the food deficit by getting her additional spending power every month, so she doesn't run out after 2 weeks, she can maybe run out after 3 weeks. That, we think, makes a market difference. In addition, by hooking her up with local resources like social sector resources, job training, childcare, we think we can help her get back on her feet and then hopefully get her back to be a more stable member of society. We need a big safety net for when things don't go well, but we also want to create a ladder for people back to independence. And that's what we think we're able to do by hooking her up with those resources. Now, if you don't believe the social resources are going to help her, or the government resources are going to help her, or the private resources are going to help her, then you're right, nothing's going to change. Our premise is that if you actually give her the best resources from all three sectors, her life will be better off. And that's what we're saying.
Yeah, trust.
Is that answering?
It did, but Maria gets $100 more, and let's assume it helps her and her life gets better. But someone else gets $100 less, and because the supermarket is spending less on advertising or something like that, won't spend more. They want to have the same bottom line at the end.
So they would probably shift some of their advertising budget from television ad or newspaper ads targeted to me and my friends to targeting Maria to win that that incremental dollar. But our goal here is to be her advocate, right? Because we think that getting her incremental spending power when she's traditionally ignored really makes a difference in her lives. And it is heartbreaking to be in the stores watching the stories of people really making big decisions about how much food to buy and how much money they have. And if you only get $250 a month from the government, getting an extra $100 of potential spending power really makes a difference. Plus, there's other services she gets too, which is fun. But I can tell you more about this later.
We have 1 minute left.
Oh, sorry.
Thank you very much. I'm Rodney Ferguson. I'm the president and CEO of Windrock International, and we're an international development organization, but an unusual one in that we have a large domestic program, and we're the largest provider of technical assistance to farmers markets in the United States.
Oh, love the topic.
So this is fascinating, and a couple of thoughts and a question. Can you say a word about the revenue model for Win-Win?
So Win-Win is a 501c3. We firmly believe that these assets will only work if it's in a 501c3 and it's a public good that anybody can access, that any company can access, any 501c3, and any government can access. We think if it gets privatized that it will lose the integrity of what it is.
Right.
So that's Win-Win. That's what I do. Propel's revenue model is they actually are a lead gen business. So they charge the retailers and the manufacturers and other people who want to market and advertise to this customer base.
And but that's partially related to my second question. For the incentive program to provide a financial incentive for Maria to use the product, do you run into any regulatory issues with USDA that is protesting the use of what they see as their SNAP program as to incentivize people to use it?
It's actually quite the opposite, because what we're taking is an existing government program that is an okay program, but it's not modern. And we essentially have taken a private sector solution to turbocharge it, and we're taking those assets and we're stretching them further, we're making it more relevant. I can show you later, but we've actually created an interface to government right on her smartphone, so if she doesn't get her benefits, she can hit a button. If she's hungry, it gives her the National Hunger Hotline. It shows her where the closest food bank is, and it makes the whole system simply work.
And lastly, it strikes me that in that regard, you should be talking to the mobile phone companies as well.
Of course.
Because if 7% have a smartphone, that's a huge market.
I was in T-Mobile's office last week, and they're highly interested in the 20% of the 30% people who don't have, and they see apps like this. This would be a reason for them to give out free cell phones, frankly, to people, as long as they do it in a collaborative manner.
We're
totally
out
of time. So, all right. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.